Hi, and thank you everyone for taking time from your day to join our webinar. Today's topic is the importance of autofluorescence in retinal pathology diagnosis. The webinar will be presented by Dr. Jerome Sherman, a graduate of the Pennsylvania College of Optometry and distinguished teaching professor at the State University of New York. Dr. Sherman also practices in the private sector at the Eye Institute and Laser Center in New York City and is actively researching the area of clinical ocular disease and special testing. His publications include over 750 clinical articles, research manuscripts, book chapters, 2 CDs, and 4 books. As just one housekeeping issue, please feel free to enter your questions at any time, and we will address them at the end of the presentation. And now, Dr. Jerry Sherman.
Well, thank you very much. So I think everybody knows the topic, the importance of autofluorescence in retinal diagnosis. And as far as disclosures go, I lecture pretty much for all the major companies that exist, and that includes Optos as well, and a lot of the OCT companies. The agenda, we're going to start with an overview of autofluorescence or fundus autofluorescence. I'll probably just drop it to AF in a little bit. We'll interpret some images. We'll give examples of hyper and hypo autofluorescence. We're going to cover cases, and yes, we will have questions and answers at the end. The case studies will include these 15 disorders shown here. I would have liked to do 50, but we didn't have time for 50, so I guess we'll have to be satisfied with 15. As an overview, well, let's ask this question. How many of you currently use FAF to treat your patients, or if not treat, to diagnose your patients? And let's everybody get an answer, and we'll submit the answer. And are we going to get an answer here of what the submissions are? I guess we'll find out in a moment. Okay, yes, I do, and no, I don't. So we have more yeses than nos, which is great, actually. I'm a little bit surprised. I think in the real world, I don't think more than 5% of optometrists actually use autofluorescence at the present time. But those numbers may be inaccurate. It's hard to get those numbers. Okay, AF in the diagnosis of different disorders, it certainly gives us, on occasion, a therapeutic advantage to make a diagnosis and then to treat early. The disorders listed here are some of the ones we're going to speak about. And to begin, let's just talk about autofluorescence imaging in general. It's not invasive. We're not injecting into the antecubital vein sodium fluorescein. We're just taking pictures. And it's very helpful. The autofluorescent property of the retinal pigment epithelium allows us to look at the integrity of the retinal pigment epithelium. And since the RP is so intertwined with the photoreceptors, when there's an RP problem, there's going to be a photoreceptor problem as well. And we can see that every time we look at OCTs to make those comparisons as well. It does provide information over and above conventional imaging techniques. We'll give a bunch of examples a little bit later where the autofluorescent image is abnormal, but the standard color image or the binocular indirect ophthalmoscope view is actually normal. AF allows us to visualize metabolic changes at the level of the retinal pigment epithelium and helps to identify areas that may be of high risk, such as in patients with geographic atrophy or CNV. There are lots of other examples beyond those two. Simple interpretation, the general image of autofluorescence, we usually see the disc and vessels as being dark because there's no lipofuscin, which is really the aging pigment that gives us the autofluorescent property. This aging pigment lipofuscin is produced by the outer segments of the photoreceptors, and it's pretty much stored in the retinal pigment epithelium. So we can have a normal gray or granular sort of glow, as we see here. I'm looking now, and you can't see my pointer, but let's say in between those two red pointers going out in this left eye temporally, sort of the typical gray that we see. In addition to that, certain areas can be lighter. That's shown with an arrow. So that would be an area of hyperautofluorescence, and below with a second red arrow, we can see zones which are dark, which means hypoautofluorescence. Hyperautofluorescence identifies sick cells that result in a bright white image. These cells are not only sick, but they're metabolically active as a general rule, or overactive. Hypo, on the other hand, hypo-AF tells us about dead cells, which give off no signal, and they usually appear as dark gray or black. There are a couple of exceptions to this, but these are the general rules. And ultra-wide field autofluorescence reveals abnormalities which can't be viewed with other imaging modalities. Think about it for a second. You can dilate a patient to 8 millimeters, use a binocular and direct ophthalmoscope, and you may be very good with it, but you're not going to see abnormalities at the level of the autofluorescence that we can see with, let's say, a Daytona system. A lot of these findings are invisible even to indirect ophthalmoscopy through a dilated pupil. Examples of hyper and hypoautofluorescence. On the left, you can see a zone, a bright zone of hyperautofluorescence. So that means that the retinal pigment epithelium at that level is sick or overactive, metabolically too active. And on the right, you see some zones of hypoautofluorescence. In this instance, this is actually a chirpy lesion. This is really not dead tissue, so this is one of the exceptions. The tissue is still there. The retinal pigment epithelium is still present, but what's happening is there are no photoreceptors above it, hence lipofuscin is not being produced. So it has this is one of the two exceptions that I know about. Let's talk about some case studies. We'll begin with something easy, and as a general rule, we're going to give you the diagnosis before we actually go into the detail. So the first condition is a choroidal nevus, which by definition is something that exists at the level of the choroid. This is an ultra-wide field color image, and we can see this lesion in this left eye, nasal to the disc, and it looks like a darkly pigmented lesion. It occurs in about 10% of all patients who get this procedure, ultra-wide field imaging. And it probably is at the level of the choroid. We're not really sure. We can certainly see choroidal vessels. The retinal vessels are going back to the disc. All the choroidal vessels are these much thicker vessels, which are telling us we're actually getting a view, even with the standard, red and green together, as you'll see in just a second. So the composite view. We can take the composite view, and every time we do get a composite view, we always have access to the red laser separation and the green laser separation. The red laser separation will penetrate deeper than the green, as you can see in the lower right, and that allows us to see the choroidal vessels. If you look at the green laser separation, that doesn't penetrate beyond, say, the retinal pigment epithelium. It allows us to see the retinal vessels well, but the choroidal vessels disappear. In a similar fashion, this lesion appears to be present on the red laser separation. That's the one in the big red rectangle, and it's not present on the green laser separation. So that suggests that this lesion is at the level of the choroid and is not at the level of the retina, so we don't see it with the green laser separation. Green laser separation will show us abnormalities which are primarily anterior or in front of the retinal pigment epithelium. We can now look at the autofluorescence of this patient. Again, the vessels are dark, and the disc is dark, and the macula is slightly dark also. In addition to that, we have a subtle granularity. But notice it doesn't show up on autofluorescence. So what does that mean? The autofluorescence is telling us about the retinal pigment epithelium, the integrity of the retinal pigment epithelium. That lesion, we're assuming, we actually gave it a diagnosis. We said it's a choroidal nevus. So it's below the retinal pigment epithelium. It's at the level of the choroid. Hence, if it's not adversely affecting the retinal pigment epithelium, it should be invisible to autofluorescence, which it is. Okay? That helps us to determine where the lesion is and what it is. If it did show up on the autofluorescence, it could be a different lesion, like a chirpy lesion, for example. We'll talk about those again a little bit later. An interesting disorder we're going to talk about now, we'll call this one an amelanotic choroidal mass, which means we're saying it's the level of the choroid, and it's amelanotic, which means it doesn't have pigment. We can actually have malignant melanomas, which are amelanotic. Here's the color image on the upper left. That's the color composite with the Daytona. And on the lower right, you're looking at the image in autofluorescence. Notice that this lesion is hyperautofluorescent, which means the retinal pigment epithelium, that zone, are sick and or metabolically very, very active. The lesion could be, as I mentioned, an amelanotic malignant melanoma. It could also be any type of inflammatory lesion, like an inflammatory granuloma due to either sarcoid, syphilis, or TB. By the way, every time I see a lesion, what I do is do an OCT through it. We're not going to talk about OCTs today, but this is an elevated lesion. It was about 650 microns elevated. And some of these lesions have been named by Carol Shields, and it's called a sick lesion, and that doesn't stand for being sick, but a solitary idiopathic choroiditis. So that's a patient who has, we think, an inflammatory disorder that doesn't seem to change. It was there. There's one isolated lesion. So this patient really deserves a follow-up. This patient deserves a fluorescein angiography, which we'll talk about a little bit later, where we want to see whether there's leakage or are there any new blood vessels growing into that lesion. And this patient may deserve a systemic workup, at least a systemic workup for inflammatory disorders such as sarcoid, syphilis, TB, et cetera. So we don't really have a bottom line on this patient. Patient never showed for the fluorescein, but hopefully we'll be able to get this patient back. Here's the right eye of the same case. It looks fine. Here's the left eye. You can see the lesion, sort of an amelanotic lesion. It's without pigment. And here's the autofluorescence of the same lesion. So autofluorescence is very useful to tell us that this is actually an active lesion, sick RPE, metabolically active, and could be something that we have to be concerned about. So this patient deserves a full workup, if at all possible. Let's go back to congenital hypertrophy of the RPE. This is CHIRPE, congenital hypertrophy of the RPE, known as CHIRPE lesions, sort of group pigmentation, if you will. Here's the color, and this is now the autofluorescence. These lesions appear dark. According to Carol Shields, who I spoke with about it, she's seen about 250 of these in every single case, she said, in CHIRPE lesions. They are hypoautofluorescent, as we're seeing here. So again, in this instance, it's an exception. It doesn't mean we have dead RPE. It really means we assume that the photoreceptor is over the lesion when we do OCTs through these lesions. The photoreceptors are not present, hence lipofuscin is not being produced, and there's no lipofuscin to be absorbed by the retinal pigment epithelium, so the lesions look dark. So this is something that's important to know. About 10% of eyes, somewhere between 9 and 11% of eyes, have CHIRPE lesions, and the same number have nevi. And of course, they're going to look different. The nevi will disappear on autofluorescence, and the CHIRPE lesions will show up as dark lesions, as we can see here. Here's a CHIRPE lesion from a student of mine, actually a resident. You can see it's supratemporally in the right eye, a darkish lesion. What does it look like in autofluorescence? Here's what it looks like in autofluorescence. So it's dark. We did do OCTs through this, and it's congenital hypertrophy, so the RPE is still present, but the photoreceptors above it, the PIL line, the photoreceptor integrity line, is actually missing. So that's something that is a little bit of an exception, but it's something to keep in mind. Stargardt's macular degeneration. Stargardt's macular degeneration is the most common form of macular degeneration in youngsters under the age of 20 or so. And here's what it might look like. This is a patient of mine referred by my brother. It's an 8-year-old whose acuity dropped from about 20/20 slowly over a period of a year and a half to about 20/200. And all the doctors that saw him thought he was malingering, because they saw nothing with the color image. However, if you do the autofluorescent image, clearly something is going on. The macula is dark. The oval macula is too dark, so that's hypoautofluorescent. Around it, this large area within the arcades, is hyperautofluorescent. So that's retinal pigment epithelial cells that are sick or metabolically active. And you can see the spots, or the flecks, if you will. And these flecks are very, very typical of Stargardt's. Sometimes in Stargardt's, maybe a few years from now, we'll get dark flecks. In this instance, all the flecks are bright, hyperautofluorescent. Typically in these types of retinal degeneration, Stargardt's and virtually all the retinitis pigmentosas and all the cousins of RP, we get very good symmetry between the right and left eye. Here we can see this beautiful symmetry between the right and left eye, and this helps us make a determination that this is actually an inherited disease. Specifically, the gene here is an ABCA4 abnormality. We know that because we did genetics on this patient. Notice the flecks, the hyper autofluorescence flex, but in a few years, some of those may be dark as well. Central serous. Central serous chorioretinopathy is actually a fairly common condition. Here in Manhattan, every time the stock market drops to 1,000 points, I see a few patients that come in with central serous. And here's a patient that has not only central serous, which is probably not obvious from this image. Cuties are actually good, but it's not quite a lesion right in the fovea. But in addition, the disc looks a little bit unusual, and the disc is actually pale. This patient has two disorders. It turns out having glaucoma and also having central serous. But let's talk about the central serous. Here's the left eye of the same patient. I think you can see the vertical cupping. You don't really see much going on at the level of the retinal pigment epithelium. But let's go ahead and do the autofluorescence. Here's right versus left. Both look pretty good. In autofluorescence, we see a dramatic abnormality. So we have a lesion which is supratemporal to the disc, which is dark, hypoautofluorescence. Then we have these other larger lesions, which are hyperautofluorescence. The one that's sort of going down, we call that an ascending tract, and that's fluid that's going inferior because of gravity. Of interest, the left eye has three lesions, as you can see, one supratemporal, one inferotemporal, and one just temporal to the disc. And if we look at these a slightly different way, we can compare the images, you know, the right versus the left eye. Obviously, this patient has more of a problem in the right eye. Acuities are still pretty good, 20/20 minus. Left eye is 20/20 plus. Fovea is not involved. So central cirrus doesn't always affect the macula or the fovea. Patients can actually have good visual acuity. Here we're comparing the Daytona color image to the Daytona autofluorescence image. And notice that we're getting so much more information from autofluorescence. Let's look at this a slightly different way. Okay, and notice that first circle, the one supraotemporal off the disc, with the autofluorescence, we can clearly see a dark, you know, sort of lesion, hypoautofluorescence. The retinal pigment epithelium is dead. And if the retinal pigment epithelium is dead, so are the photoreceptors, because they're so intertwined. If you look at it in color, that supratemporal, it actually looks normal. The one a little bit temporal to that, maybe you can see a little abnormality in the color, but clearly looks like hypoautofluorescent lesion, or most of it does, on autofluorescence. The lesion below, infratemporal, if you will, we have the oval, that's showing on color something that looks completely normal. But on autofluorescence, clearly there's something going on there. And then we have the lesion right below the disc, which really is not at all apparent with the color, but shows up pretty well on the autofluorescence. This patient has central cirrus. We know that because we've done OCTs and also fluorescein angiography to actually show where the leakage is. OCTs are very, very useful in these cases as well. But it's amazing how many patients we see with central cirrus that actually don't know it. So these are patterns that sometimes, if the fovea is not involved, the patient may be completely unaware of it. Even in the left eye, which is much less involved, there are three lesions, and those three lesions are pretty much invisible to ophthalmoscopy, but easy to see with autofluorescence. Part of the lesion is a hyperautofluorescent, and part of them, like that one temporal to the fovea, there are some hyper and hypo zones. So some of the tissue is dead, some of it is metabolically active. So central cirrus is a common condition where we actually see lots of abnormalities on autofluorescence. Let's talk about wet AMD. This patient is 89 years of age when this picture was taken, and there's not much going on in the macula. If you go out temporally, there's lots of drusen and changes in the retinal pigment epithelium, actually both nasally and temporally. If you look at the autofluorescence of that image, we don't see much going on centrally in the central 10 degrees or so, but we do see some granularity nasally and some more granularity, a little bit less perhaps temporally. So there's some abnormalities that show up on the color and also show up on the autofluorescence. Let's look at the left eye. Patient came in at age 89 complaining about blurred vision in the left eye, and the patient actually had a fluorescein done. This goes back a bunch of years. It's an interesting case. The patient's older now, of course, about 10 years old, is still alive. And what the fluorescein showed was a definite leakage in the macula, between the disc and the macula, and the patient had choroidal neovascularization membrane, a membrane growing. Back then, this is a little bit before the anti-VEGF age, one of our retinal specialists decided that the best thing to do here was to treat this patient with laser, and he did. Amazingly, he was able to treat the patient with laser without affecting the fovea, and that's tough to do. The fovea is still uninvolved. The patient's acuity is still 20/20 minus in this left eye, amazingly, and that white lesion is actually a scar, if you will. There are some peripheral lesions, as you can see also, some drusen and pigment and RPE changes in the peripheral retina. Here's what the autofluorescence looks like in this image. So the vessels look dark, as we expect. The disc looks dark, as we expect, but the lesion is also dark. The lesion is dark because the retinal pigment epithelium was completely destroyed by the laser. Again, fortunately, if you look really carefully, the fovea is still relatively intact. I have my pointer at the fovea, but not going to be able to see that. But you can sort of get some sense of where it is. So this patient's remarkably lucky. The treatment worked very effectively. One of the points to make here, this patient had peripheral, mid-peripheral and far-peripheral drusen and retinal pigment epithelial changes even before the patient had anything going on in the macular area. So we can do that. Some patients have sort of like pan-drusen, pan-retinal degeneration. And even though there wasn't much going on in the posterior pole of the left eye, then when the patient came in, the patient actually had choroidal neovascularization. And the good news is it was treated in a timely fashion. So drusen and age-related mac degen can certainly occur in the macula where you expect it to occur. But don't be surprised at all if you see changes in the mid-periphery, as you can see some here, and in the far periphery, as you can see here, mostly nasally. Comparing the right and left eye in this image, we're seeing that the right macula is not really much going on. There may be some very subtle granularity, some very, very subtle drusen. We can also pick those up on OCT. But the left eye has this large area that was lasered. The tissue was destroyed. It is a blind spot, but the fovea was spared and the patient still sees well. Okay, let's talk about the transition from dry to wet AMD. Here's a patient that we were following for a few years, actually about 5 years, who had dry AMD in both eyes. At this point, the left eye is still dry. The left eye is on your right. And you can see some granularity of the retinal pigment epithelium, which is showing up on this autofluorescent image. The right converted, the image on your left, which is a patient's right eye, that one converted at some point in time, going from dry to wet, and that happens maybe 1 out of 9 cases or so. And the patient had hemorrhaging and a fibroglial scar, and there's this bright horizontal band that you see going across on the autofluorescent image in the right eye, which is on your left, and that actually corresponds to a retinal pigment epithelial rip, where the RPE actually rips and it coils up on itself. And the coiling of the retinal pigment epithelium, so you're looking at more than one cell, if you will, one cell layer thick, that has typically this hyper autofluorescent pattern. So if you ever see this, this is very typical of a patient that has wet AMD and had a retinal pigment epithelial rip with the tissue wrapped up on itself. This patient was, of course, treated with anti-VEGF injections, actually within about 12 hours of the time that we made the diagnosis of the patient being wet in the right eye. The patient went on to develop a wet macular degeneration in the left eye, and we have this whole series documented with autofluorescence and with OCT. This patient, by the way, we did genetic testing on the patient, and there were some genes that were abnormal, complement factor H, high-risk alleles, which is not atypical in such a case. Unfortunately, the patient continued to smoke, and even that increases the risk of developing serious macular degeneration by about a factor of 3 or so. So we think that was part of the whole problem. And we could use autofluorescence, as we also use OCT, to tell us whether the condition is changing. So here on your left, you can see where the red arrow is, and that shows you where the lesion goes up to. About a month later, we have that red arrow at the same blood vessel, and we can see that the lesion, the abnormality at the level of the retinal pigment epithelium with the abnormal autofluorescence, extends further temporal than that. So it's very simple to use these images over time to show change. And that may suggest that the patient needs additional treatment. The next case is fundus albopunctatus, which is a form of congenital stationary night blindness with dots in the eye. The pictures above, the images above, are the standard Optos system. This is with a Daytona with colors. That's the color composite. And this is a youngster. He's about 9 years of age. So we can see a lot of reflections off the internal limbic membrane in the color images. By the way, none of those reflections off the internal limbic membrane show up in the autofluorescence patterns, which are below. In addition, if you look at the right eye, which is on your left, 3 disc diameters below the disc and slightly nasal, you see a lesion that's probably hard to define. However, that same lesion doesn't show up on the autofluorescence, which is right below it. That tells us that that lesion is most likely in the inner retina, not in the outer retina. You know, the retinal pigment epithelium is in the outer retina, and the retinal pigment epithelium becomes abnormal, as you know. In this sense, this lesion disappears with autofluorescence, so it's actually just reflections off the internal limbic membrane. Some young patients have such dramatic reflections off the internal limbic membrane, we can't even see below it to get some sense of what's going on. In any case, you can see this patient has a whole series of little dots and spots, which are much more obvious on autofluorescence than they were on the color images. Okay, let's talk about Hirata's disease. Hirata's disease is interesting because it can affect the front of the eye and the back of the eye. When it affects the front of the eye and the back of the eye, we usually talk about it as being void Kayanaga Hirata. Sometimes it affects only the retina, but it really doesn't matter. We still have the responsibility, you know, for the patient, and certainly we're most interested in the retinal abnormalities. And those can lead to blindness. If we look at these images above, this is a patient with known Hirata's disease. And we can see the color images above, and below that we can see the autofluorescent images. Notice that there are some zones that are dark, which means the retinal pigment epithelium has died, but we also see bright zones, which are metabolically active or sick RP cells. So the lesions below the autofluorescence of the right and left eye are showing activity. Not the dark, but the light zones are showing activity. The hyper autofluorescent zones are showing activity. In contrast, look at this patient. This patient has a retinal disease as well. We're looking at the color images above and the autofluorescent images below. Below, we're pretty much seeing only dark zones. And those dark zones are telling us that the retinal pigment epithelium is pretty much dead. But we're not seeing the bright zones as we're seeing in this case before. Does that matter? Well, it really does. Because these patients, when they have active retinitis, they should be treated with typically systemic steroids or possibly steroid injections into the vitreous. So this case that we're looking at now really should be treated. And the second case, everything looks like it's under control. There's nothing active, shouldn't be treated. So autofluorescence could be very, very useful to tell us the difference between active and inactive lesions. We can make the same point in a more common condition on toxoplasmosis. This patient had a history of congenital toxoplasmosis, and congenital toxo often affects the macula. This patient came in knowing that he had two large macular scars, and those two macular scars, one on the right eye, one on the left eye, reduced the vision to 2400. So this is actually a low vision patient who was referred to us by our low vision clinic. So here's the image. So we have a central macular lesion, which is typical. We have some peripheral lesions, which are also typical. There's one large peripheral lesion in this right eye, which is out temporally at about 9:30 or so. Now let's look at autofluorescence for that. Of interest, the central lesion looks, dark. We don't see, so it doesn't look active. It looks inactive. It looks like we have dead cells. Acuity, again, was 2400 in that eye because the photoreceptors as well as the retinal pigment epithelium are gone. But of great interest is that lesion temporally, which has a sort of a bright band around it, the annulus. So it's a dark lesion, hypoautofluorescence, dead tissue. Dead retinal pigment epithelium photoreceptors, but a bright band around it. That bright circular zone around it, the annulus, is actually hyperautofluorescence, telling us that this could be an active lesion. You put a three-mirror lens on this eye, and you actually see some cells in the vitreous right in front of that lesion. So we assume that it's actually an active lesion. That lesion doesn't necessarily have to be treated. We usually don't treat toxoplasmosis unless it's threatening the macula. That one's not, and the macula's already gone, or threatening the disc. This one's pretty much in the mid to far periphery, and will probably burn itself out, but this patient should still be followed carefully. The point being, autofluorescence is giving us additional information in this instance, which was not obvious in just the color images. Here's the left eye. Again, we have that macular lesion causing acuity to be reduced to 2400. Again, congenital toxoplasmosis and some lesions above, some satellite lesions. But here on the autofluorescence, we're not seeing any large lesions with bright surrounds. There are a couple of spots supratemporally, some small spots that are somewhat bright, very subtle hyperautofluorescence. And this eye should be followed also to make sure it doesn't become active. And, toxoplasmosis, even congenital toxo, can reactivate. Based upon who you read, maybe a third of these reactivate at some point in the patient's lifetime. It's not that unusual, especially if something is going on with the patient's immune system. Okay, let's talk about a case of what we think is plaquenil toxicity. One of the reasons for considering autofluorescence is because of plaquenil. Plaquenil is a very commonly prescribed med, and if a patient is on plaquenil about 400 milligrams for a period of 10 years, they have about a 1% chance of developing a macular toxicity, a plaquenil toxicity. This specific patient is 39 years of age with a history of having systemic lupus erythematosus for about 15 years. The maculas really look pretty good when you try to get good views of them close up. Acuities are still 20/20. Patient's not having any major problem. Seeing readings a little bit slower than it used to be. And here's the autofluorescent image. And this is very typical of a bullseye lesion. We're getting sort of a dark center, and there's a surround to that, and another surround. And some of these bullseye lesions look just like this. Some can look a little bit different. Sometimes we actually get multiple, concentric circles. But these are bullseye lesions. The center is telling us that maybe it's a little bit darker than it's supposed to be, so there may be some abnormality of the retinal pigment epithelium. But clearly the zone around the fovea is certainly bright, hyper autofluorescence, and that tells us that those cells are metabolically active or sick. And this condition will probably keep on going, will keep on progressing, especially if the patient continues on plaquenil. Even if you make this diagnosis and DC, stop the plaquenil immediately, there are some cases in the world's literature where this condition can go on for 5 years after the patient has stopped the plaquenil. That's because the plaquenil seems to have an affinity for the retinal pigment epithelium, and by stopping it, it doesn't get rid of the drug at the level of the RPE. So think in terms of these bullseye lesions as possibly being due to Plaquenil. If the patient's not on Plaquenil, but some other drug, like Accutane, we've seen this in Accutane toxicity as well, but let's say the patient has not been on any drugs whatsoever. This kind of a pattern, a bullseye pattern, can be a cone dystrophy, it could be a cone rod dystrophy, it could be Stargardt's disease. Azor, let's talk about Azor. Azor is a condition that you may not know about. It was first mentioned in the world's literature by Don Gass in 1993. It stands for acute onset. Z is zonal. Certain zones of the retina are affected and not the entire retina. The first O is for O, for occult, meaning that it's invisible to ophthalmoscopy. And the OR at the end is because it affects the outer retina. So AZOR stands for acute zonal occult outer retinopathy. Etiology is not really well known, but it's probably an autoimmune disease. And in some cases, we actually treat this with a drug called Imuran. This specific patient that we're going to see is about a 60-year-old female that I've been following for about 10 years, and she had AZOR lesions, a large AZOR lesion in her right eye. Then she came in maybe 2 years ago complaining about some photopsias and some blurred vision in her left eye. Still measured 20/20 minus or so. But as we can see here, there's a lesion which is above the fovea, and we don't have the color images here. We should, but it wasn't at all obvious on the color images. But we can see that lesion. And that dark lesion, which is right above the fovea, it's about a disc diameter in size, does have some bright spots around it, suggesting that this may be active. It may be metabolically active, and maybe it will progress. We followed this patient. We saw the patient 2 months later. And here the patient is 2 months later. 2 months later, the lesion looks completely different. Now, it looks like a dumbbell, if you will. The disc is involved. The disc was not involved back here a couple of months earlier. And you can see there's a bright band around the entire lesion. So this is still active. If we look at this over a period of this, just this two-month period, we can see in the upper left when the patient first started to complain, and on the lower right. And we'll look at that. So dramatic change in a relatively short period of time. So this patient is now a candidate for being treated with one of these meds that may actually be useful, you know, for autoimmune diseases. And there are a bunch of them out there. We mentioned one, but the important factor is the fovea threatened? And if you look at the image, which is to your right and below, part of this lesion, the bottom part, seems to not have a bright band, so hopefully that won't spread into the fovea. I've seen this patient since this image was taken, and it seems to be about the same. So there is an inferior field defect associated with this superior lesion, but it hasn't quite gotten to the fovea, so her cuties are still pretty good. She had cataracts removed. Her age was about 65 at the first presentation that we saw in the upper left. So at this stage, her AZOR seems to be active, but it doesn't look like it's going into the fovea. So a patient like this actually has to be seen every month or so to make that determination whether the patient should be treated with some med for autoimmune disease, which this probably is. Okay, the next case, atypical retinitis pigmentosa. I'm giving you the diagnosis, but it's not at all obvious what's going on when you first see the patient. Patient is a 45-year-old female complaining about some difficulty driving at night, and her fundus looks like this. She's also about a 4.5, 5-diopter. So her disc looks okay. Her macula looks okay. If we go out all the way temporally, we see sort of a pigmented lesion, and this pigmented lesion looks fairly typical for, say, paving stone degeneration. Now, if you're close to the age of 50 and you're close to having 5-diopters of myopia, you have about a 40% chance of having paving stone. Paving stone is common, more common as you get older, and very common in myopes. So that's the right eye. Acuity is 20/15, by the way. The first thing that the doctor who referred the patient to us tried, he tried glasses for driving. It just increased the minus by about a 0.5 diopter for possibly empty field or night myopia. And the patient said it really did help, but she still felt that she was having some difficulty, and then the patient was referred in. Here's her left eye. Again, the disc and macula look okay. We go out all the way temporally. We can clearly see a lesion, which looks very much like paving stone. Maybe it is paving stone. Here is the autofluorescent image. Obviously, there's something going on in the macula. We have this arcuate lesion, which is hyperautofluorescence, which means it's metabolically active, 6 cells. Nothing is dyed yet, but probably will soon. And if we go out temporally, we can see what looked like the paving stone as the dark lesions, but there's a bright band in front of it, which is sort of perhaps marching towards the posterior pole. So that doesn't occur, those kinds of bright bands in the far periphery. That doesn't occur with a condition, a standard condition like paving stone. So this is actually a form of retinitis pigmentosa. Now, typically when we talk about RP, we talk about lesions that start in the mid-periphery. We see a bunch that start in the mid-periphery, but we also see several, more than just one or two, probably maybe six or seven I can think about, where the lesions are in the far periphery and in the macula. In the mid-periphery actually looks okay. In order to convince you that this is an abnormality, which is like retinitis pigmentosa, you're going to want to see symmetry in the other eye. And there's really beautiful symmetry between the two eyes. And let's go back and just show you that again. Okay, so here's the right eye and the left. We had a transition which is not showing up for some reason. But in any instance, clearly you can see that this was invisible to ophthalmoscopy. In a sense, the macular lesion is invisible to ophthalmoscopy. Clearly very easy to see on autofluorescence in both the right and left eye. And ERGs were done, ERGs are reduced by about 50%. So this is a somewhat of an unusual presentation of retinitis pigmentosa. And really, the basic eye exam, even with a binocular indirect ophthalmoscope and a three-mirror lens, we really didn't see a macular lesion, any lesion within the posterior pole. The peripheral lesion that we saw with a BIO just looked like a typical paving stone, which is very common in this, patients who are nearsighted, 4 to 5 diopters of nearsightedness, and patients about 40 to 50 years of age. So that is a diagnosis of retinitis pigmentosa. We've seen about 100 patients with RP over the last couple of years. We have autofluorescence of those. Here's one that's not mine, which was just published, I guess, this month by Peter Hirst in Australia. And this is sort of an interesting case as well, and we've seen some that look like this. Here's the lesion on color. As you can see some of the pigmentary changes, which is typical for retinitis pigmentosa. But then we look at the images on autofluorescence. And we're seeing a sort of a ring, again, another one of these sort of bullseye macular lesions, which we're not seeing with the color image. So this patient may have some symptoms of difficulty seeing at night, may actually have some problems reading. Acuity may still be good, but that macular lesion, that bullseye lesion, will typically get smaller and smaller and smaller, and as it gets smaller and smaller and smaller, it gets closer to the fovea and will wipe out the fovea. So that's an active lesion that will continue to create problems for this patient, and the patient has it in both eyes. Here it is in the right eye, and we can see the pigmentary changes, which are easy to note. What we can't really see with a standard color or with binocular indirect are the bright zones. So we have that sort of macular bullseye, which is very, very obvious and symmetric in the right and left eye. And then the mid-peripheral zone, mid to far peripheral zone, which is also hyper-autofluorescent. So this patient has retinitis pigmentosa, which is clearly active and progressing. That peripheral lesion will become closer to the posterior pole. The central lesion will keep on growing closer to the fovea, and eventually, unfortunately, visual acuity may be lost. A few things we might be able to do for these patients, vitamin A palmitate, 15,000 to 18,000 international units. Fish oil has been shown to be effective. Lutein zeaxanthin and mesozeaxanthin also have been shown in some small studies, or at least case reports have been used where it's actually useful. A vaguely similar story, it's similar here only because of those rings that we're going to see. Typically, the rings that we see, that I just mentioned to you, are found only in retinitis pigmentosa. The only other condition where we see these sort of like mid-periphery lesions can actually occur in high myopia. So here's the highest myopia I've seen in the last 5 years. This patient's a minus 34. Patient was presented at ARVO where we actually had 3D MRIs, which is pretty interesting. Here's the color image. And we're seeing sort of some rings. By the way, pigmentary changes are also very common in very, very high myopes. And this patient has about a 36 millimeter axial length. And we can see a lot of sclera in the posterior pole, and then there's a ring around that and a further ring. So when we do autofluorescence, perhaps it's not that unusual that we're actually getting some rings. So this is a patient that has these rings secondary to sort of like multiple posterior staphylomas at different levels. you know, which are going further back. And you can see that with the 3D MRIs that we have. In any instance, at first glance, you can certainly get this confused with retinitis pigmentosa with these rings as well. So those are the only two that I've encountered that have these kinds of rings. And there's the composite of the right eye. And we're getting perhaps some additional information with autofluorescence, more areas of abnormality. And I guess we're getting close to the end of this, so let's make some comments about conclusions. Okay, we covered 15 cases. I would have preferred covering 50, but perhaps at a different time. Fundus autofluorescence should be included in all comprehensive eye exams. The technology is available. The technology is remarkably useful to pick up things that we might miss, and it certainly assists us in the diagnosis and management of a whole series of retinal and choroidal diseases indirectly, if you will. And perhaps surprising to most people, there are a number of disorders that are invisible to ophthalmoscopy, even BIO and 3-mirror lens, and invisible to color photography, but remarkably easy to detect with autofluorescence. And certainly autofluorescence can differentiate active from inactive lesions in a lot of cases, and that may allow for more timely intervention. I thank you.
Great. Thank you so much, Jerry. That was great. So we're going to get to some of your questions now. Are you ready for questions, Jerry?
Yes, I am.
Okay, great. So let's start with what is the most prevalent pathology confirmed by fundus autofluorescence?
Well, if you live in Manhattan, it's going to be central cirrus. As the stock market keeps on going up and down, these people, you know, these stockbrokers and the people who invest in the market heavily, because of the stress associated, central cirrus, we think, is a condition of stress. It's also a condition associated with a thick choroid, by the way, which is an observation that we're now making with OCT, a pachychoroid, if you will. But in any instance, it's not rare at all. Some patients have it and don't really know they have it. You know, so they don't have blurred vision centrally. But autofluorescence is really useful to show the extent of the lesions. It also shows us that it's not just central cirrhosis. When I say not just central cirrhosis, you used to think that these are macular lesions. But most of the lesions are actually outside of the macula, and the patients may have good visual acuity. Sometimes what you try to do is reduce stress to treat these patients, if at all possible. And there are some treatment out there, something called photodynamic therapy, that's actually shown to be very helpful in some patients who don't respond to just a tincture of time and judicious neglect. Usually we tell the patient it's just going to go away by itself, and it usually does. But it's important in the differential diagnosis. In addition to central cirrus, certainly in the age-related macular degenerations, drusen, pigmentary changes, geographic atrophy, where we generally get these rings around the geographic atrophy telling us that these hyper-autofluorescent rings is telling us the condition is progressing, the lesion's going to get bigger over a period of months to years. It's useful there. It's clearly very useful in all the retinal degenerations, the Stargardt's diseases, the cone dystrophies, the retinitis pigmentosa type of disorders. And it's certainly also very useful in the inflammatory and infectious diseases, where we can tell if something is active or inactive. That's sort of a quick list. I hope that's not too many for you.
That's great. Thanks. All right. We have several questions here. One of the most popular questions is fundus autofluorescence a billable procedure? If so, what is the code? And can I bill both color fundus photos and AF photos on the same day?
To my knowledge, you can't. To my knowledge, we're using the same code. I know some people have developed a different code, but I think most of the people I know are using just a color fundus photography code.
Okay, great.
It would be good for somebody to develop a special code for it, because it really deserves a code of its own, because it's so useful. And it is, in a sense, a different procedure.
Okay. Can you please discuss macular degeneration more? Will the drusen be hyperfluoresce? Wet with start to show hypo due to dying cells?
Okay. Drusen can appear. Some drusen are actually invisible to autofluorescence. Some drusen are actually hypo and some are hyper. So it gives you a sense. It's really sort of dramatic. It can be the whole spectrum. The ones that are sort of where the color image actually shows you more drusen than the autofluorescence, those are the ones we probably don't have to worry about. The ones that have large areas of darkness where we've already lost tissue, and we see that very often, that there's dead tissue that's not really visible. You may see a few drusen, but then when you look at the same area with autofluorescence, you can see large areas of hypoautofluorescence of really dead retinal pigment epithelium. And then sometimes we still get the bright zones. And we've actually seen a bright, you know, drusen that sort of glow, if you will, with hyperautofluorescence in the mid and far periphery. And a couple of those patients actually have Alzheimer's disease. And that's something that we can probably hear more about over the next, 5 years or so. It is possible that autofluorescence may be useful in the early diagnosis of Alzheimer's disease.
Okay, great. Thank you. some questions about plaquenil toxicity. Have you heard of plaquenil toxicity be helped with lutein? And what were the vitamins used for RP? Lutein, dextrosin, vitamin A.
Lutein, zeaxanthin, and okay, yes, vitamin A. Usually, vitamin A palmitate. There's some evidence. Elliot Burson was the major person who's associated with that. 15,000 to 18,000 international units of vitamin A palmitate. Lutein, zeaxanthin, and mesozeaxanthin. There's some evidence of that. Fish oils. There's some evidence of fish oils may have some, some effect. Glasses are useful. We want to try to keep light to a minimum. Blue lenses, blue filter. You want to block out as much of the blue as you can. That's useful. And any patient with retinitis pigmentosa goes out in the, daylight or skiing should really be wearing a good pair of sunglasses. That's certainly helpful. The good news is there's a ton of research being done. And my sense is in the next 5 to 10 years, we're going to have an answer for a lot of the patients with RP. Specific treatments. There is a form of retinitis pigmentosa called, it's something that you can be born with, and that condition labors congenital amaurosis. If it happens to be an RP69 gene, that's actually treatable. And there are about 25 people around the world who've been treated successfully with normal copies of RP65. So there is at least one, sort of cousin of retinitis pigmentosa that can be treated. And the people that do this for a living feel that it's going to be one gene by one gene, once you know the gene, you might be able to actually do something about it. And that's how it worked with Leber's congenital amaurosis, which is really very similar to retinitis pigmentosa, except you're sort of born with it.
Thank you. So there's a couple questions on AF versus FA and, how the lesions appear. Can you talk about how...
If you're looking at black and white lesions, the first thing to say to yourself is if the vessels are lit up, if they're white, okay, then somebody put a needle in somebody's arm. On fluorescein angiography, the vessels are white. On autofluorescence, the vessels are dark. That's the first difference. The second major difference is autofluorescence is telling us about the integrity of the retinal pigment epithelium and secondarily about the photoreceptors, which is tied very closely to the retinal pigment epithelium. Fluorescein angiography is an injection into a vein, and that will light up all the arteries and veins in the eye. And that really is a very useful device to give us information about what's leaking and what's not leaking. So fluorescein angiography really is good to show us leakage, whereas autofluorescence is really giving us information about abnormalities of the retinal pigment epithelium. So the names are similar, but they're really completely different. And there are different indications for both.
Okay. All right, we've got a couple minutes left. We've got lots of questions here. In a nutshell, can you tell us again how to do the different diagnostics between a nevus and a melanoma of the choroid?
Okay, I can try. A nevus is, by definition, a benign lesion at the level of the choroid. It should not affect the retinal pigment epithelium. Okay. If you're doing standard, Daytona images in color, it will show up with the red laser separation, because the red laser separation penetrates through the retinal pigment epithelium into the choroid. And since it's a choroidal lesion, it will show up on red laser separation. It will not show up on green laser separation. Green laser separation is really giving us information about structures which are in front of the retinal pigment epithelium. on autofluorescence, if indeed the lesion is at the level of the choroid and is not affecting the retinal pigment epithelium, it will be invisible. It won't show up at all on autofluorescence. Okay? Not a bad idea to do an OCT through those patients, you know, through the lesions to get some sense of the elevation. And there are a whole series of things to know about, you know, nevi. But nevi are very common, of course. About 10% of eyes, or 10% of patients, have nevi with, you know, with ultra-wide field imaging. And a malignant melanoma, which we're very concerned about, the numbers are only about 5 to 7 cases per year per million population. 5 to 7 cases per year per million population. So one's very, very common, one's very, very rare, but you never want to miss a malignant melanoma. Generally, a malignant melanoma will show up at all levels. It's going to be something that's pushing through from the choroid through the retina, and it will affect the autofluorescence. And if you have OCT available, you'll see certainly an elevation. Nevi can be elevated, but usually certainly less than a millimeter with OCT. And when we talk about malignant melanomas, they're usually elevated a lot more than that. With B-scan, we usually talk about a number of 1.8 millimeter elevation, and above we start to think in terms of melanomas. So a few different tests put together may be useful. But autofluorescence is very useful. If it doesn't show up, if it disappears on autofluorescence and it disappears on, let's say, the color, specifically on green laser separation, then the chances are excellent that it's going to be a nevus. However, if you do a cross-section through it with an OCT, you can see that the photoreceptors may be missing, the photoreceptor integrity line, and the patient may have a corresponding visual field loss.
Okay. So sticking with that theme, how do you tell the difference between a malignant melanoma versus a chirpy?
Okay, chirpy lesions are, you know, actually chirpy lesions could be many, or it can be, you can get an isolated chirpy lesion. The ones we showed before were sort of bear tracks, if you will. Those are not elevated at all. They're usually on OCT, if you go ahead and actually do measurements, they're actually thinner. Malignant melanomas are, by definition, always thick. There's always a, you know, a thickness to them. Typically, a malignant melanoma will show up not as a hypoautofluorescent you know, lesion. It's going to show up as a hyperautofluorescent lesion. So it's usually active. It's, you know, an active lesion. It's you know, it keeps on growing, so there is activity there. So the retinal pigment epithelium is involved. There's too much of the lipofuscin. So generally, we think that virtually every patient who has a chirpy lesion is going to have a dark lesion with no elevation, and every patient who has a malignant melanoma will have an elevated lesion, and it should be certainly hyperautofluorescent, not hypoautofluorescent. So I think usually you can tell the difference.
Okay. What about fundus autofluorescence of atrophic retinal holes or tears?
In the far periphery? I think it could go either way. If the retina and the retinal pigment epithelium are missing, with the RP being missing, you're going to see some dark zones, and that dark zone, can be a tear. Of interest, I should probably mention this: hemorrhages in the peripheral retina, which are not rare. We think hemorrhages in the peripheral retina occur about 5% of cases with Optos imaging, with ultra wide field imaging, and those peripheral retinal hemorrhages on autofluorescence usually appear as dark. You know, the red little hemorrhages appear as dark. And often, not all the time, but in the majority of cases at least, perhaps even in the vast majority of cases, hemorrhages are easier to see with autofluorescence than they are with color photography. Again, it's not because they autofluoresce. It's because they're sort of like seen in contrast with what's around them. So the normal glow that we talk about, that gray glow, may be present, but if you have spots in front of it, little tiny spots in front of it, those can be small hemorrhages. And again, I'm finding, and there are no good studies on this that I know of, but I think about 5% of all patients have far peripheral hemorrhages. And many of those, maybe half, have, you know, they're associated with diabetes, sometimes hypertension, sometimes with, you know, weightlifting and that kind of thing, where, you know, people are, you know, putting pressure on all the vessels in the body. We see that, you know, which is also not at all rare. So there are a few other things to look at, but hemorrhages is something that I think we didn't mention in this lecture, but are important because hemorrhages really show up usually very, very well as dark spots, on, especially in the peripheral retina, on autofluorescence as dark spots.
Do you think that AF is the single best test to detect plaque toxicity?
Michael Marmer, who's the world's expert on this stuff, what he says, you know, the three new procedures that we talk about for plaquenil toxicity to pick it up, one is autofluorescence, which is very useful. We very often get the bullseye, as we talked about. But those bullseyes can occur in other disorders as well, as we also mentioned, cone dystrophy, even Stargardt's disease. But you can usually make the differential diagnosis based upon what the patient's on. OCT is very useful, as is mentioned in the position in the sort of the paper published by Mike Marmer and others. OCT, typically, initially, you're going to get the bullseye, and the bullseye would mean that the photoreceptor integrity is intact under the fovea. The patient has still good visual acuity. But if you do microperimetry, you get these tiny little rings of abnormalities, you know, these ring scotomas, if you will. And that slows down the patient's ability to read, even if they have 20/20 acuity. The third test is very useful, hard to do. I did one today. It's called multifocal ERGs. And multifocal ERGs are very sensitive to early plaquenil toxicity. Which is the best of the three? Michael Marmer tells us that in any single case you don't know. And he recommends doing as many of those cases as you can, meaning as many of those procedures as you can, in addition to doing a 10-2 visual field, which is also very helpful. In some cases, 10-2 visual field may give you an earlier diagnosis. Often they agree, sometimes they don't. Again, from the world's expert, the more you test, the more likely you'll pick up the abnormality, if indeed the abnormality is there.
Okay. Thanks. Does white without pressure have any evidence on autofluorescence, or is this a good way to differentiate between white without pressure and other conditions?
Good question. I've seen it different ways. It depends how significant the white without pressure is. Sometimes white without pressure, you know, is affecting the underlying retinal pigment epithelium. So I can't really make a generalization of that. I haven't really looked at like 50 cases in a row and see if there's really a specific trend that would be very, very helpful. So I just use it in combination with everything else. Certainly white without pressure, you can see with the color images per se, you know, the standard color images, just sort of white zones. But I don't know if I can, you know, give you a definite trend that would be very, very useful in large numbers of patients. It's something that we actually should look at more carefully.
Okay. Let's see. Here's a question about children. What age would you start with fundus autofluorescence? They're finding it difficult to image a five-year-old.
Well, the youngest patients with Stargardt's in the world's literature is a patient we contributed to the world's literature, and we were able to pick up OCT abnormalities and autofluorescent abnormalities at age 4. And I actually had to bribe this little girl. She's adorable. After I looked at her brother, who you actually saw before, he was the 8-year-old with Stargardt's disease, and I looked at the two kids, his two sisters, one at age 5 and one at age 4, and both had Stargardt's, 3 out of 3, which is sort of amazing for an autosomal recessive disease. And this is actually proven with genetic confirmation of an abnormality in the ABCA4 gene. In any case, the 4-year-old I bribed. I had a piece of chalk, and I had permission from mom to do it, and I put it down, and I said, if you stay still for 20 seconds, you can have this piece of chocolate. Okay, and after having trouble imaging her, I got her to stay still for 20 seconds, got beautiful images that published both OCTs and ultra-wide field autofluorescence in color. And some of those, if you want, they're actually in Retina Revealed, one of the more recent cases. We have those three SIBs together with all the images of those three kids. So we were able to image 4-year-olds. The youngest I've imaged is a 6-month-old. And that took some difficulty, but it was actually a little tiny baby, and it was a family history of glaucoma. And amazing, I was able to get an image, and sure enough, this patient had a large disc with a giant cup, looked like physiologic cupping, at age like 6 months. So somehow we're going to have to follow that, you know, for that youngster. So sometimes you can get really lucky and image youngsters. But, you know, 4- and 5-year-olds, I can generally do it without too much difficulty.
Excellent. Okay. What is the difference between using a blue laser or using a green laser for fundus autofluorescence retinal imaging? Is one better than the other?
Oh, that's an interesting question. The original, I guess the original, is probably Heidelberg Spectralis. They were the first one, I think, who were doing autofluorescence. And it goes back a bunch of years. And they used blue, and they used it at 488. So the wavelength was 488. Optos uses 532, which is not in the blue range, it's more in the green range, and it's actually safer. As you get closer into the blues, the short wavelengths, it's actually it's more danger to the retina. And if you're doing it with, and I have, in our office, we have both of these systems. We do have Heidelberg, and we do autofluorescence. But usually you can't get a good image if you just take one. Usually you're averaging 10 or 15 or 20. I remember when we were involved early on with the Daytona with autofluorescence, and we were determining whether we should be averaging images, maybe taking two or three or four images and give her the average. We found that the single image was practically as good as the average was. So it didn't give us much of an advantage, but it's much harder to take multiple images than do the average. Heidelberg, typically you're going to average it, which means you're going to, and of course, very often you're doing it in a patient has a condition, such as Stargardt's, where light is dangerous. You're using blue light at 488, which is dangerous, and you're not doing it once or twice. You might be taking 10 or 15 or 20 images and averaging it. So there is some indication that we're better off in the green zone. The other issue is important. Somebody has a lot of, like a yellow macula lutea, the term is probably the term that you learned, and that's due to the presence of lutein, zeaxanthin, and mesozeaxanthin. So the yellow carotenoids are absorbing the blue light. What happens if you're using 488, the blue light, a lot of patients who happen to have a lot of carotenoids will wind up with dark maculas because a lot of the blue is being absorbed by the carotenoids. And you sort of can over, I've done this, I've over-diagnosed maculopathies in patients with 488. So the Heidelberg has certain advantages, but in this instance, I feel better being in the green zone as opposed to being in the blue zone, and I feel a lot better with taking single images as opposed to taking multiple images and averaging them, which exposes the patient to a lot of light. And again, in conditions like Stargardt's, we actually think the light is deleterious.
Thank you. I want to be respectful of everyone's time, and you've done such a wonderful job, Jerry, that we still have probably over 20 questions to answer. So we are going to take a copy of all these questions and get answers to them and send them out to all the attendees. So I wanted to thank you, Jerry, for your time and for your excellent presentation and knowledge. And for everyone that attended and submitted your questions, we will definitely get back to each and every one of you. And you will be receiving an email after the presentation is over with a hyperlink to the recording so that you can share that with your colleagues as well. So that is our presentation for the evening. Again, thank you, and have a great night, everyone.
Thank you for attending, everyone. Take care.